Support WrestleTalk!
Give us a subscribe.
What next for Sting in AEW? I am Luke Cohen, and I'm joined as I am every single Friday by the hardest working person in all of sports infotainment, my favorite podcast co-host, Denise Salcedo. How's it going, Denise?
I love the way you introduce me. You know, you're giving me a big head, Luke. My head's just growing bigger and bigger by the minute.
I've got to put you over, man. I've got to put you over.
Thank you. Thank you. Please rate me 7 stars. I'd appreciate it.
So, yeah, I mean, it was a bit of a, I mean, really, there was no other title that we could have done for this week's episode. Like, usually I get up on a Friday morning. I'm like, okay, what's the news? You know, I'll have a look at what the news is. What's the news topic? Really, there was only one thing to talk about. It was either this or the Impact thing. And yeah, it's just like yesterday, like the wrestling world went crazy in 1 2-hour show of AEW Dynamite, because not only did Kenny Omega win the AEW World Heavyweight Championship from Jon Moxley, he is now partnered with Don Callis, who in turn is partnered with Impact, and AEW are now partnered with Impact Wrestling. We're going to find out more about that on Impact next Tuesday. But also, Sting, it's Sting, the icon Sting, the man called Sting, debuted for All Elite Wrestling in a segment with Cody and Dustin Arnanson and Darby Allin against Team Taz. And I said this in the AEW review yesterday. I listened to a lot of wrestling review podcasts. Yesterday was one of the days where I was listening to every single one I could get my hands on. Like, I was listening to you, I was listening to Wrestling Over Radio, I was listening to Going in Raw, I was listening to Fightful. I just wanted to hear people talk about this moment. And it was just this like sort of shared feeling of like excitement of being like, Sting debuted. And which is weird because like it's 61-year-old Sting, but we're all like dead excited.
It doesn't even matter, like the age.
Right? No, it's amazing. But like, yeah, I mean, what did you make of the moment?
Okay, so first of all, did you see my tweet?
Yes, I did.
When everything was going down, you know, it was crazy. So first of all, like you mentioned watching my show, first of all, thank you. And secondly, I was like crazy writing down all of these notes. AEW sent a press release like immediately following that. Everybody was posting like all of this stuff. So like it felt very chaotic in that like whole like 1 hour, hour and a half spear. And so I went to yours and Louie's page and I was like, are they watching right now or are they asleep? Like, I'm not really sure what's going on. And I think Louie, his last tweet was like 4 hours ago prior to all of this. And yours was a couple hours prior to that too. And I was like, oh, they're totally asleep right now. I was like, they have no idea what's happening. So I had to, you know, basically tweet, somebody wake them up. So I thought that was kind of hilarious. But dude, it was so crazy. But I got to say, it makes me so happy because you just said something very pivotal. So you said you wanted to listen to all of these podcasts and listen to all of these reactions. I will tell you that yesterday, I can almost guarantee that anybody who has any sort of podcast saw a very large increase in their numbers. Why? Because people felt the exact same way that you did. They were like, oh, I want to know what so-and-so thinks. I want to know what so-and-so thinks. And that's how I felt too. Immediately, I wanted to do the same thing. And it's like, yeah, it doesn't matter like if you have your own show or your own opinion or whatever, you want to talk about wrestling, because especially there was this big moment. And for the most part, I think from what I've been seeing, I think everybody sort of feels on the same page where they feel like this was a big moment. And, you know, some, it may not be like a game changer. Obviously, you know, AEW still has got a long way to get to the WWE level, as we know, just because, you know, the difference in history and time length and all of that. But it definitely felt big in the sense that Tony Khan has essentially been out here, you know, promoting his shows and, you know, kind of exaggerating things every now and then. But this time you got to give the man some credit, some kudos, because he finally paid off the whole, the power of balance is shifting in wrestling. And I was one of those people who are like, dude, you shouldn't have said this. Come on, you're over exaggerating. And I had to take back everything that I said, because the whole thing with Sting was just, it was awesome. It was a great moment.
Yeah, like it was that and the Impact partnership as well. Like, you know, there were a lot of people who were super mad at TK like the day after because they were like, you were talking about Pac. Come on, man. Like, that's not the balance of power shifting. That's Neville coming back. And Tony Khan's just there, like, looking at all those replies, being like, oh, just you wait. Just you wait. Give me a couple more weeks.
Luke, I was one of those people. I was on my podcast going like, dude, you lose so much credibility when you do this. I even like put out a tweet saying like, you can't be doing this. Like people are going to start not believing you. And then when you really are hyping something up, no one's going to buy it. And they're just going to be like, it's just Tony Khan being Tony Khan. And so, you know, I had to take my words back and swallow them because, hey, he actually delivered this time. And it's crazy too, because, you know, we had the Sting return. We have this, you know, revelation or this big reveal that Impact and AEW are now working together. And it's crazy to think that the third most talked about topic is the fact that Kenny Omega is now AEW World Champion. And there's just a bunch within all of that. I mean, it was wild. It was a wild night.
Like, Moxley had a 277-day reign. Like, that's not a short reign. He didn't have it for a month or anything, and then they just switched the title over. Like, he had it for pretty much all of 2020.
It's wild. I mean, I can't stop saying wild today. It's because it really was. Like, last night was so stressful. I was legit stressed because I was like, okay, I got to get this show up. I got to get my notes out. I got to make sure I tweet so that I get some hits out. And then, like, third of all, like, I got to make sure that the news is being posted and whatnot. But I loved it, though, because the better something is in wrestling, the more people are talking about it and the more you finally feel like you're watching something that is fun and cool and newsworthy.
Yeah, it was so awesome. I saw your tweet in the morning because, you know, a lot of people replied to it as well with, like, the, you know, got to wake Luke up and find out what he's thinking on this. And, like, the thing that made me laugh the most is that, you know, I don't open Twitter, I don't open Discord, I don't open YouTube or anything like that. But if I'm going to watch a show like this, like, I don't even do it from watching Raw, and I don't tend to usually care about Raw. I just don't want things to be spoiled for me in case something big does happen. So, like, I open up Twitter and all of a sudden there's just people like me, like, oh, if you're looking at Twitter now, go away, stay away from Twitter now. And I'm like, oh man, I'm so glad that I did not open up this platform first. And
so, like, what's the process?
I just sit down and I watch the show. I open up my notes. I sit down and I watch the show. And then once all that's done, I then go onto Twitter to see what people are talking about.
You know what? I'm exactly the same way when it comes to Taylor Swift albums. No lie. I do not go on Twitter when she reveals any sort of documentary. You'll notice that I'm very, very silent when Taylor releases anything because I like to have the moment, you know? So I kind of feel like you're in this moment. You don't have anybody else's, like, opinions embedded in your head. They're your own authentic opinions.
So on the question of what could be next for Sting, I love the fact that, like, Sean reported yesterday that no one knew that he was there, which has been backed up by the Bucks since then. They were on John Alba's podcast and said that they hid him in his own trailer for, like, the entire day, like, minutes before the segment they brought him out. And as they were walking through the back, all of a sudden everyone's head starts to be like, what? Sting's here. And, like, you know, Sean said that he got a text from someone just minutes before it happened saying, like, if you're not watching Dynamite, you need to switch the channel right now. So, like, that was really cool. But Dave Meltzer has said on Wrestling Observer Radio, he's going to be a regular on television. They wanted this idea of a big star from the old generation, TNT, being back as a regular. Whatever physical stuff he does, they're going to have to do it very safely. There will be physical stuff, but I don't think he'll be taking any bumps or anything like that. But he's going to be a character in some form. Now, Sting said earlier this year that he could wrestle again if he has successful surgery because he had spinal stenosis, which is what Edge had. So we've seen in 2020, Edge had that successful surgery and was able to get back into the ring. He was in the Rumble, the greatest wrestling match ever, et cetera, et cetera. So there is the possibility that Sting could have one last run per se. But as it currently stands, according to Meltzer, he's not having big matches. So I guess that my question to you is, like, what would you like to see from Sting in AEW in this scenario?
I just think I want to see something creative. And last night we had that big moment feel, and I hope that they preserve it. They preserve the feeling. You don't want it to be like, oh, it's Sting, he's on this week. Yeah, great. Okay, whatever. Moving on. No, I want them to preserve the fact that, like, hey, this is Sting and this is a big deal that he's even on here. And I think I would like to see, you know, some big moments. I don't know what those moments are, but I would like to see them for him because, you know, after WCW, like, yeah, you know, a few years later, we we did see him in WWE, and he had some great moments in there, but I don't necessarily think they were those kind of moments that you would expect somebody like Sting, the Icon, to essentially have.
Yeah, no, I agree. Like, I think that the WWE run was like, it's a real shame because I wanted it to be so good. Like, when he debuted at the Survivor Series 2014, I was like, oh, finally, Sting's in WWE. We're going to have that Sting WrestleMania match. There's so much here for them to do. And all it led to was a Triple H match, which was, I think we can safely say now, was misjudged. In that, like, people did not want to see WWE versus WCW. It'd been dead for 20 years. And then it was the Seth Rollins match, which ended in, you know, an absolute disaster. And it was very unfortunate for both men. Sting, perhaps more so. So, like, the WWE run was, it's a bad taste. Like, I want to see something good for Sting. If he can get the successful surgery, if he can get into the ring a couple of times, I would like to see, you know, two pay-per-view matches a year from Sting. I don't want to see him wrestling. Maybe like one episode of Dynamite, you build up as this really big thing, like, oh my God, Sting's wrestling on TNT, and it's the first time in 20 however many years that he's doing this. But I don't want to see him having matches every week. Like, I don't want to see him become a overexposed character. I want to see him, like, keep Sting special. You've got something really special with Sting. So, like, make, you said that, you know, you keep that momentum, you keep that special aura and feeling about him. Don't put him out on TV every single week, because the more you do that, the more that aura goes away.
Exactly. And it's kind of hard to say, because imagine you have Sting on your roster and you're like, well, I want to use him every week because it's Sting. So that is very hard to say. And, you know, you mentioned the fact that you don't want him to be, you mentioned the fact that you want to see him maybe wrestle maybe twice a year. Let's just say that it's possible, because, yeah, I hate to say it, but you don't want to see him become, you know, somebody like The Undertaker, where you end up having these not so great matches, because obviously, you know, time just gets to you, and that's just natural. But it is sad, because then, you know, people start talking and people start saying negative things, and then that really starts to take away from the grand aspect of whatever wrestler you're talking about, somebody like The Undertaker. And you don't want to see that happen to Sting.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I'm a TNA mark, you know, at least I was a TNA mark way back when, and I was a big Sting mark for when he was in TNA, but I am not one who is, you know, I'm not ashamed to admit that his main event matches in TNA towards the end of his run weren't particularly great, because what they were was Sting in a t-shirt, and he had a 9-minute match, 8 minutes of that was brawling through the crowd. It was, you know, just like smoke and mirrors. It was just like, what little can we do in the 9 minutes that we have? We'll just wrestle through the crowd for 8 minutes, get in the ring, Sting a splash, Scorpion death drop, then we'll, you know, 1, 2, 3, we'll end it there. So I don't want to see that from Sting. What I want to see, if we're going to get Sting matches, I want to see this be the big finale for Sting, the big retirement run for Sting, get that big retirement match, that big sort of closing moment for his illustrious career. A man
and
who
has deserved it.
And he deserves a man who's been in WCW, TNA, WWE. He's been on these big platforms. And you're absolutely right. He totally deserves to have that big retirement moment. That's kind of what I would like to see from Sting. And then I don't know if I can, I'm not sure if like manager Sting is something I can particularly, like Arn Anderson as a manager makes sense. You know, like Jake Roberts, Tully Blanchard, like they make sense of manager. Sting as a manager, I'm not sure makes, like, I can't quite visualize him. Like, is he just gonna wear a suit or like a sports jacket, but with the makeup?
That is, and it's funny too, because if he were to dye his hair black, you would never know that this guy is, you know, 61 years old. 61. You wouldn't know that whatsoever at all. 60.
I was stunned when I was reading him yesterday. I was like, he's 61. I was like, are you sure? Because like my dad is like 65, but like my dad looks about 20 years older than Sting does.
He could date my grandma, all right? I was telling that to my fiance. I was like, you know, because Sting and my grandma have the same birthday, March 20th. And I was like, yeah, you know what? They could be a couple. I could see it. Sting could be my grandpa, whatever. But yeah, no, it was just really cool though. But okay, so, you know, obviously there was the rumors. There had been rumors about Sting joining AEW. To be honest, when I heard those rumors, I laughed. I was like, it's not going to happen. Whatever. So were you like surprised that, like, even with the rumors, people were still surprised that it was, you know, him?
Well, yeah. So, I mean, I predicted he was going to be there at Full Gear, like, because they had the merchandise thing where he'd stopped, like, WWE and his merchandise deal fell through. Like, they hadn't re-signed. So I was like, okay, I think he's heading to AEW. He's been tweeting about it all year long. I think he's going to be at Full Gear. I didn't, but this is kind of the genius of all of this, really. And I think the genius of AEW and Tony Khan and the creative team that got there is it was all one big misdirect. Because it didn't happen at Full Gear, I didn't expect it to happen at all. Or like, you know, not until the next pay-per-view. I thought they would save it for a big pay-per-view. And because the show was built so much around Moxley, Omega, and the world title, I didn't think they were going to do anything big like Sting. So when Sting debuted, it was like a, oh my God, Sting is here. Like, so even though I, as a fan, and sometimes a bit of a jaded fan who was like, you know, doing this as his daily job, that's reading all the news and stuff, I still was surprised. And I'm proper marked out. Like, this whole thing, I'm like, oh my God. I genuinely welled up. Like, I got genuinely emotional about this. I had a tear that rolled down my eye. Helped by the fact that...
Yeah, you should have recorded your reaction.
Oh, man, I know.
But nobody expected it. Nobody thought, hey, something's going to happen. Let me, you know, record myself just in case. There's been times where I've tried to do that and then nothing happens.
Yeah, like I said to Ollie, like, I really wish we'd done a live reaction to the show. Like, in hindsight, I really wish we'd done a live reaction because we could have done the Sting thing, the AEW, and the title change and the Impact thing. I really wish we had done. But yeah, like, it was like someone messaged into the Fightful podcast saying, like, oh, everyone saw this coming. Like, no, you didn't. No one saw this coming. No one at the start of that segment was like, oh, this is where Sting's going to debut.
No, nobody thought that whatsoever. And again, like I said, when I heard the rumors, I thought, you guys are reaching, like, people are just dreaming way too hard. It's not going to happen. And that was just about it. And maybe that's just me being, you know, I don't know, not having these big imagination or whatever, but I just didn't see it coming. And so I was genuinely surprised. So I said this on my show, but I'll say it again. I had AEW on mute, okay? Because I was watching both shows. And so sometimes, like, I mute things, you know, just to kind of, like, you know, balance things out. And when I was watching that, the lights went down and, hey, like, there's, you know, something on the screen. But I thought, all right, it's just going to be nothing. And I'm watching. And then all of a sudden, I see the Sting words and I'm like, I pause and you see, I hop over, I unmute, I put the big screen on, and then afterwards I rewatched the whole thing just in case. And it was crazy, and it was really fun to, you know, really just, like, capture the moment. And even though there was only a couple people in the audience, it still felt, you know, really huge. And my fiance was actually watching the show with me, and he was that person that grew up a WCW fan. He didn't grow up a WWE fan. I grew up a WWE fan. So I think the moment was different for me than it was for him, because, you know, he's somebody that actually grew up watching WCW versus me. I went back and had to watch stuff because, again, I grew up a WWE fan, and there are some people, I think, watched both promotions at the same time. And then there was people that, you know, picked sides. And growing up, my uncle, who got me into wrestling, he was a WWE fan only. So that's what I was shown. I didn't even know WCW existed. Okay. That's really sad. Every time I tell my fiance that, he gets so mad. He's like, while you were watching, like, the lame product, and trolled me about it and nonstop. And I'm like, whatever, like, I know about it now, obviously, but, you know, growing up, it's very different. So I thought that the moment probably felt even more grander. It felt grander for me than it felt even more grander for those that, you know, grew up with WCW.
Yeah, no, absolutely. The lastly, before we sort of move on from this, there have been the as I said this on the show yesterday, if a tweet comes into me that starts with, if WWE had done this, that's an instant mute for me. And the argument is, like, you know, no one was excited. If Sting had done this in WWE, everyone would have been crapping all over it. I'm excited for Sting in AEW. I'm excited for him to do matches. If Sting is then in world title programs, then, and he, like, they put the title on him and he then becomes the focus of the show and they stop pushing younger guys in order to do Sting, that is when those arguments can then come in, because I don't think that is the right use of Sting. Sting is a special guy, but he is not the sort of person you should be putting in the world title picture, holding the world heavyweight championship at the age of 61. It should be guys like Omega, Moxley. It should be MJF. It should be these guys that you are building and cultivating. So, yeah, for Sting, if going after the TNT title, I think that's slightly different, because, you know, like, him versus Darby Allin seems like that'd be pretty cool. Like, that seems like pretty much everyone's been saying that since Darby Allin came in. It's like, oh, it's like a little mini Sting. It's like Sting and Jeff Hardy had a wrestling baby. So, like, Darby versus Sting for the TNT title, that, I think that's slightly different. But yeah, like, I don't want to see them overexpose him and push him beyond his means.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Again, I think they just really have to preserve it, keep him, you know, fresh, keep him, keep him exciting because he could do that himself. But I guess just don't overthink it. Be simple. I think that's what WWE did. I think they overthought the whole thing when it could have really been the simple, you know, give us the big, you know, greatest hits and, you know, the fans will eat it up and they'll love it.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, the way I would put this, don't Goldberg the situation because, hey, it was really exciting. It was really exciting when Goldberg came back. I was super excited when Goldberg came back. And then he won the title from Kevin Owens. And I was less excited about it. Then he came back again. And I was really excited. And then he beat the Fiend. And I was less excited about it.
And now everyone hates him.
Everyone hates him.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want that. But BTW, I do not hate Goldberg. I am not on that boat.
Love Goldberg. You know what he did at SummerSlam with Dolph Ziggler? That's what I want to see from Goldberg. Like, that was an amazing use of Goldberg. Right. Just before we get onto the mailbag, looking at the results from the viewership for AEW and NXT last night, probably understandably, AEW did very, very well. 913,000 viewers, so not quite the million mark, but, you know, pretty close to it, which is way up, obviously, from the 712 they did the previous week. It's the best number they've had since September 9th, and drew 1.016 million viewers in the all... Oh, sorry, that was the... They drew... The, sorry, try that again. That was the show that did that, the September 9th one. And then the show drew 543,000 viewers in the all-important 18 to 49 demographic. NXT did 658,000 viewers, which is down from the previous week, and drew 200,000 viewers in the 18 to 49 demographic. So, yeah, massive, massive jump for AEW. I would really like to hope that that will continue into next week. Obviously, Impact's going to get a great bump next week because the Kenny Omega's going to be featured on the show. So, I would like to hope that AEW can at least get into that sort of 850, 900 mark again next week, because yeah, getting one week viewing is great, but it's about retaining those viewers and making them come back to watch the show again next week.
Are you surprised that they didn't hit that 1 million mark? Because considering the promotion and everything that went into this, I kind of think it's a little bit scary that they didn't hit that 1 million mark. It's like, where are these people at?
Yeah, I'm surprised that they didn't, because, you know, that September 9th one did. And I thought the fact that it was a world title program, it's Moxley Omega, everyone figured that Omega was winning the title. I think maybe the go home show for War Games, because there were some really big matches on NXT this week, that maybe that might have affected it in some way. I don't know, maybe there's still some holdover from the holidays. I don't know. But I was, yeah, kind of surprised that it didn't hit the 1 million mark.
I will say this, though, now the fact that they have sort of embedded into people's minds, if you've noticed, they've been doing little things, not all little, but certain things on the show that are making now AEW Dynamite seem like an unpredictable show. So, I mean, just even simple things like when Jon Moxley just casually dropped, hey, my wife is pregnant at home. That's something that nobody expected, right? Then this whole thing with Sting. Another different thing, obviously a lot, you know, I guess you can say like bigger, but it was just now I feel that fans probably have it in their head or should start getting it in their head that, hey, I should tune into AEW Dynamite because, you know, something can happen and I don't want to be missing it because look at last week, Sting came out and then, you know, there's this, you know, news coming out the week before that. And I'm sure there's other, you know, little examples that, you know, will pop up, but it's just... That's good. And I think that wrestling shows need to have that because it keeps people tuning in consistently each and every single week. So like keep, you know, bringing the excitement, keep adding the possibility that anything is possible and anything can happen on the show. You don't want to go in knowing, okay, nothing's really going to happen. And unfortunately, that's the big problem right now with Raw is that you don't really feel like anything major is going to happen. And they used to have that element and unfortunately they lost it and hopefully they can get it back. And, you know, we kind of have that with SmackDown, but I think SmackDown, it's more of just like the storylines and the stars that are on there that people really want to see. So each show is bringing something different, but I do think that having the element of anything can happen would really help, you know, keep those numbers growing.
Well, let's dive into your Patreon mailbag questions. If you want to submit a question to the mailbag, all you got to do is become one of our awesome pledge hammers on Patreon at any dollar amount. Leave a comment in the community tab labeled mailbag. Do not email me. I will just lose it. Let's get through these. Jamie said, I'm back on the road running, hoping for 15 kilometers today if my old legs can take it. Best of luck to you. And my question is, when WWE stars left for AEW, there was this perception that it was the land of opportunity. For some, this worked. Brody Lee, John Moxley. However, the likes of Sean Spears and maybe Matt Hardy, that doesn't seem to be the case. At that point, is it time to look at the wrestler rather than the company?
I've always thought that you should look at the wrestler, not just the company. I think that a lot of wrestlers, they don't get the proper opportunity. And we've seen that happen. But I do think that a lot of it also has to do with the wrestler itself. I mean, look at Becky Lynch. She's talked about, you know, always being the person in the shadows, not necessarily getting her marquee moment. Look at her. She's the perfect example of somebody that found a different route to, you know, get to superstardom. And, you know, she got over. And so it's kind of, but I think it depends on your mentality and how you see things, because there's a lot of factors that go into it. But I do think a huge part of it is, you know, the person itself.
Yeah, we said this, like, even before AEW came around, is that, like, not everyone who leaves WWE gets to be Cody Rhodes. Like, not everyone that leaves WWE is going to have that. Because Cody Rhodes left WWE, right? Like, they let him go, and he was just like, okay, knuckle down. This is what I'm going to do. This is my dream. This is my list of goals, and I'm going to do everything I can to complete these goals. Whereas there are some that leave and be like, well, I was a WWE guy, so I'm going to get booked, and I'm going to get put on the marquee, formerly known as, or, you know, former WWE star, this, that, and the other. So yeah, I think it does come down to the wrestler. I think that AEW have been guilty of, like, I think Sean Spears is a good example of someone who is like, oh, this is going to be his time. They're going to really show that you can do a lot with him. And unfortunately, they haven't done a massive amount with him. Like, he had that one program with Cody, and then really hasn't done much since then. I still stand by. I think he should have won that feud, and they could have extended it out. But yeah, like, I think you're right. Like, I think it's kind of a combination of both, I think, in a way. It's like, but you don't know what you've got until, like, Becky Lynch is someone that we as fans were just like, god damn, why aren't you doing anything with Becky Lynch? She's the best. And the company were like, no, we're not. And then she became this huge star, and you're like, see, told you. I don't know if there's any, like, those ex-WWE guys in AEW that we're all saying, they're like, that guy there, with the exception of Miro, maybe. But, like,
yeah, Miro.
But he's only been there for, like, a handful of months. It's not like he's been there for 5 years and we're going like, guys, come on, Miro's right there. Like, it's been, you know, a handful of weeks. Matthew Makovsky says, hello, Danuk. My question this week is regarding massive pops that we didn't get in the No Fans era. What are some of the pops that you think the WWE or an AEW you wish had happened in front of fans? A few that come to mind. I mean, and Matthew's got a lot here, and I think he might have named all the best ones. A few that come to mind: Drew's title win, Bayley turning on Sasha, Keith Lee becoming double champion, Bucks versus FTR, the Becky pregnancy announcement, Roman Reigns' return, Pac return, Moxley Kingston feud, Drew showing up on SmackDown, Keith Lee pinning Randy Orton. Like, there's, I mean, I don't know, Matthew, you may have listed all of the moments there.
I think the only other ones would probably be the Undertaker retirement. Did he mention Roman Reigns' return?
He did.
That one. Okay, well, he got that one. And I feel like there's probably some more obvious ones, but those are definitely the key ones there, which, by the way, I can't even believe the Becky Lynch thing happened this year. That feels like that was last year. Doesn't feel like it was in the same year.
I know, it feels so long ago. But yeah, like, the Becky one in particular would have been an amazing moment in front of fans. Undertaker's retirement, like, watching it on, like, Survivor Series, we kept saying it like, this is nice and everything. In a way, it was a bit weird, but it was like, man, I wish there was actual fans here to, rather than piped in, thank you, take a chance, like an actual crowd doing it.
Poor guy, man. Like, think about it. Like, the biggest, one of the biggest legacies in wrestling history. And this had to happen when he was retiring. Like, had he just been, I don't know, retired a year later or even a year before, things would have been so much more different. Ugh.
I mean, this is going to be very bad for podcast listeners, but I want to give a shout out to your nails that you've got there. Fabulous nails you have today.
Oh my gosh. I should have redone them, by the way, but they're a little messed up right now. But, you know, I try to add some color. I try to switch it up, you know. Got to add some fun into your life. This is the only fun I have.
Well, like Sharpay, I think you look fabulous. Brian Heath says, Danuk, I hope you're having amazing weeks. What's a wrestling storyline you'd like to see in the next 2 years? Can't be an invasion or it can't be a ripoff of other storylines. Brian Heath, you're asking us to book things. Denise and I are not good at booking things or coming up with inventive storylines. We're not creative people.
Or what about like dream scenarios? Because mine is definitely seeing Hangman Page eventually become the face of AEW. That's not an actual storyline, but it's a thing that I would like to see happen in the next 2 years.
Yeah. Ollie pitched this in the news yesterday, and I totally love it, which is that, you know, we're telling this story of Hangman Page, of Kenny Omega has effectively turned his back on AEW because he's siding with Impact Wrestling and Don Callis. This is the time for Hangman Page to save AEW and win that world title and bring it back home and all that sort of stuff. Like I like, and that's the moment that we want to see is Hangman Page finally beat Omega and finally lift to that title, which it's a little, way off yet, but I can't wait for it.
That is a brilliant idea. And I hope AEW listens to that because I would love to see that play out.
Timothy Berry, thanks for reading out my question last time. It was wrestling related. However, this time I've got something different related. It's a friend. Yes, I'm a friend's Mark.
How you doing? This just happened, by the way. This was accidental.
My favorite episode is the pivot episode where Ross helps take the couch up the stairs. Can you give me your best impression of Ross yelling pivot?
You already did it. Is that your impression?
Yeah, absolutely. Pivot.
I don't think I can do it. I'm so bad at accents. Pivot. No, okay, that was so bad. I'm so sorry for everybody's ears that I just blew out right now. I'm so sorry. I don't know what I'm doing. But you know what we've never discussed? Who is your favorite Friends character? You could only pick one.
It's Rachel. Rachel is the best character. Rachel, she's the most consistent character throughout the entire show. She is the one who has got a consistent start and a consistent end. She is always the funniest person. I think that Jennifer Aniston is so underrated on that show. I think she stands head and shoulders above pretty much everyone else on that cast.
We can't be friends anymore.
Why not?
So first of all, my number one pick is Ross. I love Ross. Oh, I find him so funny. Second, Monica. I love Monica. I actually relate to her more than I do the Rachel character.
Yeah. Is it the cleaning thing?
No. It's the more of the, I don't even know. It's the very organized, no fun type of person. Like it's fun for you, but not for everybody else.
It's just organized fun. It's, yeah, you know, it's organized fun.
Exactly. I like to have organized fun.
No, I've always like, because my biggest issue I've had with Friends, like I think by series 10, you know, the final series of Friends, everyone has sort of become caricatures of themselves. So I think like Ross and Joey becomes like so dense he can barely tie his own shoes together.
Yeah.
Chandler is like making snarky remarks. Monica's whole like, everything's got to be clean, so it gets ramped up to 11. Phoebe becomes a bit more dulled down and that's nicer. Rachel is the character that she's got one really nice and easy to follow arc, and it's a wonderful arc to see of the spoiled rich girl who, you know, becomes her own person and, you know, becomes a mother, spoilers. And, you know, and I think that that's really, really lovely. And I think that, oh man, there was that person who emailed in last week. It's actually Callum. I know, cause he's got an email about questionnaire and I've just spoiled something. Really sorry, bud. But yeah, so I Rachel is hands down for me, my favorite character.
Well, she's third on my list. I love Rachel, but she's third because I love Ross. He's so funny.
Yeah, but he's also a sociopath. Like, he's
I relate to that. I relate to psychotic people, Luke. Some of us are not properly sane, all right? Some of us are psychotic.
My sandwich. Marcus... Marcus Saul Campbell, what's your favorite set from 2000's WWE? I really like the Taboo Tuesday Cyber Sunday set. On an unrelated note, what do you think of It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia?
Never seen it. And my answer is the Backlash set with the, I don't know what you call it, those things the that pincers. Like, what are they?
Pincers.
Like, is that what they're called?
Well, I think they're like, yeah.
I call them like knives.
Yeah. Yeah, the Backlash 2000 set is so, so cool. Like, it's like they're just constantly swinging. Oh, it's badass. I've also never seen, I've seen like a handful of episodes of It's Always Sunny because my wife watches it. I should really give it a go myself. But as we've discussed in this podcast before, if I'm not watching something with my wife, then I'm just, it's likely it's not going to happen because I don't have time like to myself to watch the shows because my wife and I watch everything together.
And she already graduated from TV school. She's watched everything.
Exactly. She's completed Netflix.
Yes.
Wrestling Talk Sign Guy, less of a question this one, but just some clarification to a question that we had last week, which is, I thought it was interesting. It's a bit long, so do bear with us. I'm a WWE shareholder. After listening to you talk about WWE financials last week, I want to share some information that may give people a different perspective. Profit is not only important an important number to a company. I invested right after the Saudi Arabia crisis when the stock took a hit. And while I've received about $1 per share in dividends, the stock price has actually fallen at about $11 per share despite initial recovery, meaning that for every share I own, I have a net loss of about $10. This is because of what is known as the market cap, the stock price multiplied by the number of shares, which gives you an idea of how valuable investors see the company as being. The stock price has gone down because investors don't think the company is worth nearly as much as it was a year ago. While WWE may be putting more money in its coffers as profit, the total income has gone down without things like live shows. Compared to a year ago, Vince McMahon's personal stocks were worth about $300 million less. Dividends and profits aren't nearly as important as stock price, and with the rise of AEW as a legitimate competitor, if even not a threat, I worry that WWE will have trouble growing back to its previous size. As an investor, this makes me worry about its stock price, and I may be cutting my losses in the near future, despite record profits. What I want to see going forward is how WWE plan on growing their gross income, not their profits.
First of all, I am so thankful for him to send in this information because it's very, very helpful. Secondly, I'm horrible at math, so this was very hard to follow for me. But third of all, I appreciate it. And fourth, I think I just have to see it visually to sort of understand the full scope of what he was saying right now.
Yeah, like I need Wrestling Talk Sign Guy, who's been like, he's been a fan of ours for ages. He's had signs at AEW shows, like with like Wrestling Talk, it was behind Sammy Guevara. It's really, really funny. But yeah, I kind of want to sit down with you and sort of like have you sort of map this out for me so you can like really explain this because I'm too dense, I'm too thick to fully understand how stocks work.
We need cartoon picture books. We need the children's illustrations of how stocks work. You need to put it in a picture book for us. Definitely for me. I know for a fact. You got to like explain it in a very, very basic, which he did. I'm sure it gets more complicated than what he just said right now. Way more complicated. Yeah. You know what I never get? Why are all these people screaming on the stock floor?
A film I absolutely love is Trading Places. Like I love that movie, but I don't know if I fully understand what happens at the end. Like I don't know because it's all about stocks and stuff. I fully get it.
I don't remember. There was one movie with Cameron Diaz and Ashton Kutcher. I forget which one. I think it was the Vegas one where job.
What happened in Vegas?
Yes. Isn't her job where she's like out there screaming? And I'm like, why is she screaming? Why are these people screaming? What are they doing? I don't know. I would love to find out.
Yeah. We had this when we watched The Wolf of Wall Street. And my wife turned to me and was like, I don't think I fully get how they're making money. And I was like, they are. Like, I think like the best thing I could tell you is they are. Like, that is the lesson we need to learn here. They're making lots of money.
If we have anyone from Wall Street watching us right now, please explain this to all of us, to both of us.
With pictures, please. Yeah. We need like Dora to come out and really tell us what's going on here.
Hey, that's a show right there. Pitching to Nickelodeon.
Adam Gallagher says, hi, Luke and Denise. I had a question on Quizzlemania about Vince shoot fighting wrestlers in 2020 that was taken entirely too seriously for my liking. Sorry about that. So I figured I'd pose a question that couldn't possibly be taken so seriously. What is the smallest weapon you'd be willing to defend yourself against an angry charging Brock Lesnar? No guns, that's cheating. Fun fact, I once asked Mick Foley this a few years ago at a meet and greet, and his answer was a Colt 45, hence my no guns rule. New patron, so hello, and all that. You guys are the best, even Mr. Davis. Thank you very much, Adam. I mean, surely it's got to be like the barbed wire 2x4. I mean, that's something you want to have, right?
Oh, you're so much more hardcore than me. That's a good pick. You know what I was going to say? A bow and arrow. I don't know why. Wait, does that classify as... He said small weapon. I think we're thinking too large here. We got to scope it down.
Me, if you'd have given me 1,000 guesses, I never would have got to bow and arrow. Like,
well, I was
trying over here.
I was trying to not think of something that was wrestling related, more of just something that, of a weapon that I would like to use or know how to use.
I was do you know how to use a bow and arrow?
No.
Oh, Denise, I would not suggest taking a bow and arrow then, because you're going to be there popping up shots and be falling down in front of you.
Luke, I have a question for you. Are you a Hunger Games fan?
I think I've seen all the movies. I've certainly seen the first one.
Okay, well, you should know now that I read all the books. I watched the movies. I've never gone to a movie theater to watch any movie at midnight in my life. But I did so for all the Hunger Games movies because my dream is to be Katniss. I want to be Katniss. And so that is why I want to learn how to do the bow and arrow. Even though I've never taken a class or a course, never even looked it up, I still want to do it.
Josh B17 says, hi, Luke and Denise. What is the one show from everyone's favorite match on the card wasn't your favorite? For example, Hangman vs. and Omega versus the Young Bucks of Revolution is almost everyone's favorite match from that show, but I preferred Cody versus MJF, although the tag match was great. That's a really, really interesting question, because like that Revolution show, like, you know, we always talk about the Omega Young Bucks match and Hangman Page, but like that's the same show that's got Pac versus Orange Cassidy on it, which is a great match. It's so good.
I have the perfect answer. So let's dedicate this segment to Louis Dangor. The match that everybody liked that I was like, is definitely the Young Bucks FTR.
Yeah.
Because I definitely liked Kenny and Hangman a whole lot more.
Oh, Denise.
There you go. That was my perfect answer.
I mean, it is a good answer. I mean, mine really is like, and this should come as no surprise to anyone, apart from Denise, maybe. Everyone talks about Rock Austin at WrestleMania 17. It's the Hardcore Triple Threat. It's the greatest match on the card. It's the greatest match in WrestleMania history.
I already told you I'm never going to forget that ever in my life.
Flame Ink Live says, before I ask my question, I just want to let you go. This will be my last mailbag for a while. Funds have finally run dry. Very sorry to hear that, Flame Ink Live. But you know, dude, you got to do what's right for you. So thank you very much for your months of service. First question is a tough one. If you had to give a follow-up to one of the other two, if you had to give up one of the following so that the other two had a better chance of succeeding in the world, what would it be? Would you rather give up your career, your significant other, or your best friend?
Wait, and we have to get rid of one?
Yes, you have to give up one so the other two can succeed.
Definitely my best friend, because I don't have one.
Oh, Denise, that's so sad.
I mean, I have friends, but I've never considered, I don't have like a BFF, you know, like your peanut butter and jelly. Like, I'm peanut butter, there's no jelly.
Oh, Denise, that makes me so sad, because I was going to say, like, I would give up my career because my significant other is my best friend. So that
okay, but
way,
see, that's a trick question, though. See, I could say the same thing about my fiance. I could say he's my best friend because he is, but I'm thinking more in terms of like a girl best friend. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I suppose that'd be my buddy Johnny. What's my best man? So yeah, I'd still sacrifice my career so that those two could succeed.
See, I can't do it. I can't do it. I think I would put career first. I can't do it. Oh. I could find another man. I'm just kidding. And I've said this, like, me and my fiance joke about this all the time. I'm like, dude, like, it's like my career, then you, then like everything. Actually, no, hold on. It's like Taylor Swift career. Like, kind of go from there. I'm joking.
Of course.
Of course.
Chopper JJ says, hello to Nuke. I just want to say thank you for all the incredible hard work. I'm very thankful. My question is, if you could make your own six-pack Hell in a Cell match, which current wrestlers would you pick from any promotion? Have a nice day, jam that jam. So the Armageddon Hell in a Cell match from 2000. Pick six people that you'd like to see in it, like with today's roster of wrestlers.
I'm just going to pick six people that I really enjoy. Hangman Page, Adam Cole. Mm-hmm. I'll throw in Will Ospreay in there just for fun. I'm going to throw in Kenny. I'll throw in Tommaso Ciampa. And I'll throw in Drew McIntyre.
Yeah, Drew's a good shout. I think I would take out Will and I'd put Moxley in. That'd be my only switch I think I would do from that. But that's a really good lineup. Jonathan Hedman says, hello, Lukewarm and Ebenezer. I hope you're well.
Wait, what?
Ebenezer Scrooge. Because you're bloody, like, you're shoot comments.
You're supposed to be yelling at me today. I was preparing myself. Oh, since Monday, dude. I've been stressed out about this.
Dude, it's coming up. There is a question that is coming up that I've been saving that my thoughts on your shoot comments. But anyway, hello, Lukewarm and Ebenezer. I hope you're well. First, Luke, can we all agree that the Star Wars Holiday Special is the worst Christmas Star Wars thing ever? Yes, it is. With the exception of the Attack of the Clones, which is indefinitely worse. Also, please tell me if Die Hard, Iron Man 3, Gremlins, and It's a Wonderful Life are truly Christmas movies or just movies that take place at Christmas, and what makes a Christmas movie for you? Great question, Jonathan Hedman. This is what the Patreon mailbag is all about. Die Hard, Stephen D'Souza, who I have interviewed on many, many occasions. I interviewed him for my book, has said that Die Hard is a Christmas movie. While I may not particularly agree with him, I'm not going to go against what the writer of the movie. I'm not. If he says it's a Christmas movie, then it's a Christmas movie. Iron Man 3, nope. It's just set at Christmas. Gremlins, I'm going to give a half on that. It sort of is, it sort of isn't. It's a Wonderful Life 100% is a Christmas movie. And boy, howdy, does that movie make me cry. We watched it last year at Christmas. Me, my brother, my wife, his girlfriend, and my mum and dad. And at the end of it, like, my mum cries every time she watches that movie. But this is the first time in years that she didn't cry while watching it until she turned around and saw me and my brother crying. And then that set her off. And then she started crying because me and my brother were there, like, sobbing tears, because it's such a beautiful movie and a wonderful, wonderful Christmas movie.
I've never seen it.
Denise.
I know. Don't worry. You can get mad at me later.
Oh, it's coming. Winter is coming. what makes a Christmas movie for me? If it's got a nice sort of, like, lovely sort of heartwarming message around it, that kind of one makes, like, that's why I love Christmas. I love Christmas because it's all about, like, people that you love getting together and having a lovely, lovely time together. It's the most wonderful time of the year. Like, Home Alone is a great Christmas movie, Denise. We'll get to it. Before that moment, the reuniting moment of Catherine O'Hara and Macaulay Culkin. It's just oh, getting teary just thinking about it. It's beautiful. Callum says, this Callum is where we've got the Friends problem. Sorry, Callum. I watched Friends up until the end of season one after your podcast last week. It's amazing. Can't believe I've never watched this show before. I kept on thinking during this, I'm literally Ross. So my question is, did this kind of thing come to your mind when you first watched the show? And if so, what was it? Like, so what was your sort of your first thoughts of Friends when you first saw it?
I think my first thought was, wow, this show's actually funny. Because so the reason why I started watching Friends was I was in college and I was taking a TV class. I forgot what the class was, but they showed us an episode of Friends to show an example of something. And I enjoyed it this few minutes. I was like, you know what? I'm going to give it a try. So I think I went into this and I was like, oh, I had no idea that this show was going to be what it was. But I kind of had that same thought where I was like, oh my God, I'm like Ross too. So I can get it. Like, you see a character and you start to think like, oh, I have similarities with this person.
So I started watching Friends. Season three was when I first joined on, because my brother's 6 years older than I am. And my brother and my parents watched, like, series one and two, and they would talk about it and they loved it. And so, like, when I started season, I wasn't allowed to watch it. It was almost too adult for me, because, you know, series three is like, I'd probably been, when was series three? Friends season three. When did that air? I'm just trying to work out how old I was. Friends season three aired in 1996, so I would have been 10 when the show aired. So I then started watching it because, like, oh, the cool older people, like my brother, are watching this and they really like it. And so, yeah, then it was just, I watched it because it was the cool thing to watch. And I was like, oh, this is actually really funny. This is really, really cool. Now I feel like an adult. And now I can join in with the conversations that my brother, like, I remember my brother and my parents laughing about when Chandler grows the mustache to try and look like Richard.
Aww.
And they were like, oh, it's one of the, my brother said it's one of the funniest things ever. Like, when he walks in with that mustache. And I then got to join in those conversations to be like, oh, wasn't it really funny when X happens?
You're like, I'm finally part of the adult conversation. Did you watch the show in order, like in order of the episodes?
Yeah, because like that was like, so season three started airing on Channel 4. That's when I jumped in to watch it. So maybe I was like 10, 11 years old. And then I watched it all the way through until the end.
I watched it completely out of order. Like I bounced around episodes. So I was very confused. And then eventually I ended up watching it like all throughout its, you know, completion.
I mean, I talked about this a couple of weeks ago, and I think we talk about this a lot on the podcast. Friends is still shown like every single day, 365 days a year. Friends is shown on UK TV. Like there is a channel that is essentially dedicated to it. If you have got, if there's an hour of the day Friends is on in this country, and they don't often show them in order. They just sort of like show like random episodes. Like, you know, over the Thanksgiving period, they just show the Thanksgiving episodes. So my wife and I used to have a game, which was like guess the season. So where you try and work out which season it's currently on, you'd be like, okay, well, Rachel's got that hair, but Ross and Rachel aren't together. Monica and Chandler aren't together yet. So like, you know, there's all of this sort of stuff, the way that you can play guess the season.
That's really fun. I would like to do that.
Alan Monsoon, hello Team Danuk. I'm hoping you're doing well this week. I've got another set of words for Luke to say in Spanish. Even though he may not realize it, I feel like Luke is learning and improving his Spanish every week, even though he's having trouble pronouncing orange. I can't remember how to do it, which was really funny. So I think about this because a lot of people keep sending us these Spanish words, but I don't think I'm actually learning anything. I feel like I'm literally just saying words and then I forget them.
Are you not retaining them? You're not retaining this information? You have to like practice more.
Yeah, if you'd have asked me what's blue, even though that's what we did last week, I cannot remember. But fork is tenedor.
Tenedor.
Nailed that one. Knife. What is that one? Cuchillo.
Oh, you're way off on that one.
What is it then?
It's cuchillo.
Cuchillo. Okay.
Cuchillo.
Cuchara, then, I'm going to guess is for spoon.
Oh, yeah. Okay, you did that one pretty well, actually. Cuchara, yeah.
Cuchara. And napkin, servilleta.
Servilleta. You could have had it. You just got to pronounce, like, you got to hit it harder, I think. I think you're speeding through all of the words and instead of, like, focusing on, like, each, like, sound that each, like, letter makes. If that makes any sense at all.
My wife says that to me a lot as well. Moen Carnip. Hello, Luke and Denise. Bluechew.com/ use the code FIGHTFUL. Hello, Luke and Denise. Hope you guys are doing well. Glad to hear that Jeff Hardy is doing better after that scary bump on Raw. While it was unfortunate, I think there's an opportunity for it to lead to a storyline. After suffering that bump, Jeff loses his confidence. He feels like he can no longer be Jeff Hardy and he's too scared to take all those sorts of risks. This could go on for months and build to a moment at WrestleMania where he finally does a big spot, i.e. jumps off a ladder. Anyways, just a suggestion. What do you guys think?
I never thought about that. That's actually pretty interesting. And I think given the storylines that Jeff Hardy has had to work with as of late, this one would probably be a little bit of an improvement over those.
It really would be. Jeff Baltry, greetings, lukewarm and Hollywood Salcedo. I've been hearing that WWE is possibly pushing to get live crowds back as early as the Rumble. Do you think it's smart to have crowds back in any capacity, considering the upswing in recent positive viral cases in the United States?
No, so we're actually about to go in like a serious lockdown here in California. It's been like the news like just broke today where like the governor broke things down in like regions. So we're probably going to go into like a 3-week lockdown. And so definitely here, it's not going well. I don't know about like the other states. I'm sure they're not doing as well either. But I think California is more strict compared to all the other states. So it's not looking good. Based on that, I would say no. But then there are talks about vaccines. And, you know, so I don't know. But I just doesn't feel like it. But it doesn't feel like it right now. I don't know what it's going to be like, you know, down in the summer.
Yeah, I mean, unless you just do it in Florida, where from what I gather, anything goes. Like, it's a lawless state.
It is so opposite from California. It's weird. It's like night and day in the difference.
LJ Mickey, do you think that WWE or AEW has, at the moment, any talent besides Roman Reigns that has any chance of achieving mainstream fame like The Rock, John Cena, and Batista? They do. WWE has Becky Lynch. 100%. That is a mainstream star on your hands.
Yeah, I agree. I can't wait to see her come back. I mean, I don't know when that's going to be, but I can't wait to see her come back.
Like, there's already been talk Marvel are interested in having her in an MCU movie. So,
really?
Yeah, it was earlier this year. It was before she got pregnant and everything. Marvel were really interested in putting her in a film. So I think there is a lot of Hollywood interest in Becky Lynch because she has got star presence. So yeah,
and a very unique look too. Something that I can definitely see in like a Marvel or some sort of superhero movie.
Exactly. Yeah. Right. Here it comes. Ket, what's up, guys? Denise, how dare you say Home Alone is overrated? It's one of the best Christmas movies ever. What do you have against it?
So first of all, you should know that all my social media since Monday has been flooded with Home Alone stans attacking me. The Home Alone stans are alive and well. Is that like a Home Alone thing? Oh yeah,
it's a Home Alone reference
from like the movie that he's watching. Exactly. See, I saw. Look, well, I just think it's overrated. Okay, it's completely overrated. I don't think that it hits the mark in terms of like, okay, so he gets forgotten about. Cool. All right, then he has this little adventure at home. Okay, cool, whatever. Then his mom freaks out. She's like the only one that cares. Like the dad, from what I remember, doesn't even care. Like nobody cares but the mom.
They can't get home.
You know what else I think is dumb about Home Alone? Why are they so freaked out at the fact that he's home alone? Is it really that big of a deal that he's home alone?
Kid.
Because how old is he in the movie?
I think he's meant to be under 10, I think, or maybe even about 10 years old.
I was home alone under 10 years old. You give a kid a remote control, you lock the doors, tell him not to open the door, give him some snacks.
Denise, you've got street smarts. You've got street smarts, kid. You're like Macaulay Culkin's a spoiled brat. Kevin McAllister doesn't know. That's the whole, the setup of the movie is he can't function on his own. Like that's what the first 10 minutes is setting up the fact that he can't do anything on his own. That's why it's scary. Then he's left home alone.
And then what is Home Alone 2 the one where it happens all over again? Like the same thing, like the power goes off and they miss their flight or something?
Sort of. They actually do, but like he gets on a separate flight to them and he goes off to New York and they go off to wherever it is they go. Home Alone 2 is not as good. I will happily admit that. I try and watch it every year and I'm like, you know what? It's just not as good as the first one.
It doesn't, look. I just don't get it. I feel like it doesn't pull my heartstrings. It doesn't like bring me into the movie. I don't feel the connection that everybody else feels with it. And I know that all the Home Alone stans are going to attack me because I've been facing this drama nonstop since Monday. I didn't realize how many people loved Home Alone.
I mean, Denise, I mean, you broke my heart on Tuesday. That's all I'm going to say. You broke my heart with your messages. Like, and I quote, Home Alone is overrated. And I quote, Die Hard is boring. And I quote, Christmas is overrated.
Like, okay, Christmas is overrated, though.
Denise, come on, man. It's so good.
Okay, you're a December baby. You would say that, though. Christmas is in your blood.
It's awful being a December baby. Do you know how terrible it is being a December baby when you're a child? You get, like, my birthday is 11 days before Christmas. Do you know how many years I got, like, well, this is going to be your joint Christmas and birthday present because they're so close together. Like, I have to wait the rest of the year for things like that. Like, you want your birthday in the middle of the year.
That's really sad. But I just, I just feel like Christmas is only fun Christmas Eve, and that's it. Christmas Day, we don't even do anything in my family. Like, Christmas Day, you just, like, sit at home, and you're all bored. And then, like, Christmas Eve is fun because you get to eat. And the only thing I love about Christmas is opening presents. My presents. But I'm not into Christmas music. Christmas movies, they're okay. But I don't get in that, like, Christmas spirit. Like, yeah, I'll put up lights. I decorate the Christmas tree. The Grinch decorates Christmas trees in this house. And it's all nice. And, you know, I just like to, but it's not, like, something that I'm like, oh, my God, it's Christmas.
Oh, Denise, I never thought I would hear these words from you. I really thought that you would be a Christmas kid like me. But, yeah, you broke my heart with those. And I sent out that tweet where I was like,
yeah, you, so many people responded to that. I was in shock.
Yeah, I was so disappointed. Both you and Sean, because Sean said that Elf was overrated as well. I need to have words with him while we're at it.
Please do. I like Elf. And I like Elf a lot.
Elf is a great movie. Oh, yeah. That also makes me cry, by the way. Oh, it's so beautiful. When they all sing. Oh, it's lovely.
But see, I think the difference too is that like you like sweet heartwarming stuff, right? I don't like gushy like feelings and all of that. Like I don't like crying. I don't like any of that type of stuff. So I think I try to like stay away from it.
But anyway, you said all of that and I sent out that tweet and I was like, there cannot be anything more in this podcast that will be any more controversial than those things. And then you said, I quote, I don't care for the Muppets.
Oh, yeah. I don't care for the Muppets.
Denise, I'll say that. I mean, I was about to say I was wearing Muppets pajamas. I'm not because I changed them this week. I'm now wearing Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles pajamas. But I was wearing Muppet pajamas earlier this week. I was wearing Muppet pajamas when I was listening to your podcast and how you, quote, don't care for the Muppets.
I don't care for the Muppets. Like, I just don't see what's so special about them.
They're love. They're so fun. They're great fun. They're really funny. They're wonderful characters.
They're just Muppets. They're just puppets. They're just dolls. I don't get it. And Die Hard. Die Hard was so boring. I had to turn the TV off like 2 seconds in.
Denise, we're trying to get you over with this fan base. Stop saying these things.
No, you know what? I am standing up for those people that are always silent. I'm sure there is somebody else out there, some miserable soul just like me out there thinking, finally, we have someone on our side. I'm that person. I'm speaking up for the small minority of people.
I will say that I did get a lot of people reply to me being like, I actually agree with a lot of what Denise had to say on that podcast.
See? And, Thank you. Yeah, see, they're out there.
They're getting the ban hammer from me on Twitter. I'm not having any of that negativity on my timeline. I'm kidding. I'm not blocking them.
Are you going to take it that far? Are you going to ban people if they say the Muppets suck?
If anyone tweets me today saying the Muppets suck, you are getting blocked. Like 100% you're doing that because you're just trying to troll me. So, Denise, don't you dare tweet me. I do not want to block you. I like you too much to block you on Twitter. But like,
no, I'm going to start a very controversial comment right now. Very ready for the controversy. Teletubbies are better than the Muppets.
Oh my God,
Denise. I like the Teletubbies. I used to watch them. How did that song go? Oh, I love the song. And then the little son.
You love it. You love it so much. And I know the song. I know the song. I didn't watch it when I was a kid either because I was too old when that show started. But I know the song. And yeah, and you're here going like, oh, I love the Teletubbies. It's so much better than the Muppets. Can't remember how it goes, though.
I forgot the song.
Teletubbies. It's like it's one word. Muppets are great.
I forgot the song. That's one word. And then the slime, the pink slime that comes out. Oh, as a kid, I wanted to drink it so badly. I wanted to drink. I don't even know what it was, but I love the Teletubbies.
So, a little story about me. Every year, because my birthday is, as you mentioned, it's December. December 14th, my birthday. Every year, and this will be the first year where I'm not going to do it, I go to the Prince Charles Cinema in London, and I go to a Muppet Christmas Carol sing-along. And it is so lovely. We have some mulled wine and we just sit there and we watch the movie and we sing at the top of our lungs all of the songs from the Muppet Christmas Carol. And it is a beautiful, wonderful time. That movie also makes me get a little bit teary, particularly when Tiny Tim dies. Spoilers for Christmas Carol. Yeah, it is. It's great. Last year, my mum has heard me do about, you know, because I always talk about this. And she was like, I want to go and do that with you because I've not done that before. So, we went, so it was me, my wife, my brother, his girlfriend, my mum, my dad, my father-in-law, and my mother-in-law all went to the Muppet Christmas Carol song, and we all sat in the same row, and we all sang Muppet songs. My mum, bless her heart, listened to the soundtrack ahead of time so that she could learn some of the words. It was so sweet, and I love that soundtrack, and I could sing it now, and it's just so, and do the voices as well, because it's great.
Your heart is so red. Like so red and bright and shiny. I just realized that my heart is black.
Yeah, because you're the Grinch. You're the actual Grinch. We need it's your like, heart to grow three sizes know, that day.
You do the stuff that I only see in movies. Like, you know those movies where people go and sing Christmas carols? I didn't know people really did that.
I did that last year. I went into like singing Christmas carols in the town square. It was great.
See, like, I didn't know, like, that. I guess, like, in my life, I've never done any of that type of stuff. So for me, it's like a whole alien experience.
I said to my because my wife and I are moving soon. We're moving to a new area. And I was like, oh, do you think there'll be like a Christmas caroler group that I could join and we can just go around it? And she was like, if we are, you can do that on your own. And I was like, Absolutely. And if there isn't, maybe I'll start one and we'll just go around and we'll sing some Christmas carols to everyone.
I have to send apology letters to all the movies that I watched. And I was like, wow, that is so fake. Like, no one does that. Like, who does that? Who lives their life like this? Who does this stuff? You do this stuff. You live the picture perfect life.
Oh, thank you so much. But it's here. And anyway, so I've got that off my chest now. I still consider you a friend. I still think you're a very nice person, but you're...
It's okay. People can come hate me on social media. I could take the heat.
You broke my heart a little bit. Right. There's actually so many mailbag questions. We have not got time to get into them now because we've run out of time.
People are going to hate us. They're going to be like, you didn't answer our mailbag questions.
I know, yeah. There's quite a few that we didn't get to. Let's try and do one more. Actually, do you know what? Let's end with this one. Let's end with Chris Duncan. With the sad passing of Pat Patterson this week, what are your favorite wrestling-related moments with him?
So I was listening to Wrestling Observer Radio when Dave was talking about it, and I think mainly, not a specific memory, I think it's more of the impact of a lot of the things that he did in wrestling that I thought were just like, dang, like, one person did all that? Like, that's crazy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my Pat Patterson is Stooges Pat Patterson. It's, you know, it's him and Briscoe with McMahon. And I loved Patterson and Briscoe as an act. Like, what a brilliant, brilliant combination of people. These old goofballs that are just sort of like, you know, the Mr. McMahon's like, it's Mr. McMahon. Like, I love Gerald Briscoe cutting promos for him and stuff. It was wonderful. Mr. McMahon is the man. Like, it was... And like them with winning the hardcore title, like Gerald Briscoe winning the hardcore title, and then Pat Patterson stealing it off of him, all of that stuff, absolutely loved. I met Pat Patterson a couple of years ago at Wrestling MediaCon because he was one of our special guests at MediaCon. And I didn't like fully get a chance to sort of sit down and talk with him. But the one moment I did have is I was setting something up in this sort of canteen area. Like, we were setting up to do a shoot. I can't remember who we were interviewing. It might have been Sue Young. We were in, like, setting up something to do that. And then I had to go and get something from another part of the event. So I ran down these stairs. And as I was sort of like running down these stairs, I nearly ran into Pat Patterson. And he like proper like bumped into him. And I managed to stop myself and sort of go around him. But because of my mind was so focused on getting to my location, I hadn't really considered what I nearly did. So I just went, oh, sorry, Pat, and then carried on.
Well, at least you apologized.
But I called him like, I called him Pat. Like, I was like, sorry, Pat, as if I knew him. And he was, and he just said, he goes like, oh, that's all right. And I sort of like carried on my way. And it was until later, I was like, I cannot believe that I nearly bumped into Pat Patterson. And the only thing I could think of saying was like, sorry, Pat.
Like, you could have literally asked him any question ever, or like even
called him Mr. Patton. Just at least, you know, something like showed some respect to him. But just go, sorry, Pat.
No, you know, I actually think Pat, I don't know. I'm not really a person that, is it weird to refer to people in their like last name? I actually feel it's more better to refer people in their first name. Like, I wouldn't want anybody calling me Miss Salcedo. I'd be like, ooh. That's not me.
No, I guess, but like, I think in sort of, particularly in the wrestling world, like, you know, it's one of those, like, those unwritten rules. Like, you know, if you don't go backstage and shake everyone's hand, then that's going to get you heat and stuff like that. And that's all I could think of was like, oh man, what if Pat, like, because he's an old school guy, what if Pat's going to have like heat with me now? And he's going to be like, that, he's not going to know who I am. But like, that bald guy, like, what's, you know, he ran past me and called me by my first name. The utter disrespect, the butter disregard that man had for my name.
How could he? Imagine you would be like, hey, like some security guy came up to you and like, hey, by the way, you got to go home. We had some comments about you.
Yeah. Mr. Patterson had some comments about you. And we having that happening around. Yeah, so that's my Pat Patterson story. But he was really good at MediaCon and stuff. And I heard that he and Kenny McIntosh had a great night when they went out. We didn't get to go out with him because we were so tired, but we heard that they had a great night. But anyway, that is all we've got time for on this edition. Really sorry we didn't get to all your mailbag questions. Unfortunately, Denise Salcedo is a Grinch, and we had to try and open up her heart and make it grow three sizes that day. I don't think that worked, though.
It shrunk. You know, I told my fiance, if he cries at the wedding, when I'm walking down the aisle, if he cries, I told him I'm turning back around.
Why?
I don't want him to cry. And he's like, I'm going to cry. And I was like, dude, please don't cry. If you cry at the wedding, I'd be so mad.
They cried at our wedding.
No, and that's okay. That's okay. Like, I don't care if people cry. I just don't want him to cry. I was like, I'm gonna be like, I've even acted it out for him. I'll be like, walking, like, you cry, I'm turning around just like this and walking back. Y'all can enjoy the party. I'm out. I don't know what it is. I can't have him like crying or falling.
Oh, so that's the two things you got. Like, I've only got two requests of you on that day. Don't cry or don't fall.
No, I don't like him falling in general. I don't know what it is. What just mean, like, I just find it like so like upsetting if someone falls. Like, it just, it's a character thing. Like, I, you oh know how God. Vince doesn't like people to sneeze? I don't mm-hmm. like people falling or all right, I'm done. Cancel the show. Turn it off. End the stream.
I think we're done for the day. Thank you all so much for your Patreon mailbag questions. I've been Luke Owen. This has been Denise Salcedo, and that was wrestling.